In this video, we're talking about Honda's recently announced V3 engine with an electrical compressor that, according to Honda, will become mass production reality in the near future. This video covers number one, the anatomy, benefits and drawbacks of a V3 engine layout. Number two, the working principle, benefits and drawbacks of an electrical compressor. And finally, number three, the engine balance of a V3 engine. Overall, I think this is a very interesting engine and overall a very interesting approach to powering a motorcycle with many unique benefits and challenges. So let's dive right into it. A V3 engine is in theory great because it has the width of a two-cylinder and the power potential of a three-cylinder. The layout is two cylinders in the front and one cylinder in the back. This allows us to have a very narrow motorcycle, which reduces aerodynamic drag and can also improve comfort and maneuverability. On the other hand, a V engine compared to an inline engine does force a somewhat increased wheelbase. But in this particular case, Honda's V3 is a 75-degree V, so it's not quite as long as a typical 90-degree V engine, which means that it's trying to strike a compromise by reducing the engine size a bit, while at the same time leaving enough room for a performance-oriented intake system. There is no official info on engine size yet, but most reports suggest that the engine will be between 750 and 800 cc of displacement. From what we can see in the pictures, this is obviously a water-cooled engine, as there are no cooling fins of any kind anywhere, and we can clearly see a water pump as well. We can also notice the centrally located spark plugs and the twin cam seals, telling us that this is a double overhead cam 4-valve engine. So pretty much a typical modern engine configuration, promising good performance. Also, the engine is obviously not made of some sort of one-off billet machine from billet CNC machine pieces. We have castings all around the engine, which suggests that this is indeed very close to production and may be in the very last stages of development. Now, something else that's of course extremely interesting about this engine is the electrical compressor. Now, some journalists have been calling this an electrical turbocharger or e-turbo, which is incorrect. It's incorrect because for something to be a turbocharger, it must have a turbine. And a turbine is a rotary mechanical device which harnesses energy from the flow of some sort of fluid. That fluid can be wind, it can be water, or it can be exhaust gas. But without a turbine, it cannot be called a turbo. And in this case, we do not have a turbine, just an electrical motor that is connected to the compressor wheel, which spins up the compressor wheel. And of course, an electrical motor does not harness any kind of energy from any kind of fluid. Instead, it's powered by electricity. And herein lies the actual beauty of this device. If we're using an electrical motor to spin up the compressor wheel, that means that we are completely independent from the exhaust gas produced by the engine. And that creates many interesting benefits. Number one, if we're independent from the exhaust gas of the engine, it means that we do not have to wait for a certain RPM where the engine builds sufficient exhaust gas to spin up the turbo to required speed. Instead, we can use our electrical motor to spin up the compressor wheel to maximum speed and create maximum boost whenever we want. That means that we can build maximum boost even at extremely low RPM. In other words, we can turn our torque curve from something like this into something like this. We can create an extremely flat torque curve that remains flat for most of the RPM range. Effectively, we have zero boost lag and near idle boost threshold, which results in exhilarating performance and maximized engine responsiveness. The second benefit is that because we are independent from the exhaust gas, we do not need to create complicated exhaust manifolds that all feed into the turbocharger, which means reduced weight, bulk, and cost. Because we don't need complicated exhaust manifolds, we can place our electrical compressor anywhere. And as you can see, Honda has of course placed it extremely close to the intake manifold for maximized responsiveness. The third and final benefit is that in theory we can make more power with an e-compressor than a traditional turbo. And that's because, contrary to popular belief, a turbocharger is not free energy. Yes, it makes power from engine waste, but it still consumes some power. If you look down the turbine inlet of a turbo, you're going to see just how small the space is into which exhaust gas needs to be forced. This creates back pressure that the engine has to overcome, and overcoming it uses some power from the engine. Of course, yes, the turbo creates more power than it consumes, so there's a large net gain, but it's still not free energy. And of course, an e-compressor is also not free energy, but it does not create back pressure in the exhaust system. So overall, we should get a larger net gain. What's really exciting here is that e-compressor technology has obviously matured to the point where an OEM giant like Honda is going to be putting it on one of its products. And while it is a great thing, of course, there's no such thing as a free lunch, and there are some drawbacks and limitations. One of the main drawbacks is that, as of right now, e-compressor technology is not capable of matching traditional turbos in how well and how long it can hold a constant high load. In other words, an e-compressor is much better suited to short little bursts of boost rather than being able to maintain high boost constantly. This is because, number one, the electrical motor simply starts melting, and or the electrical system starts struggling to provide the energy needed for the electrical motor to maintain a constant high boost. Because of this, and according to most reports, the system in the Honda will be producing only 5 psi of boost. This explains why there's no intercooler, because with just 5 psi, you don't really need an intercooler. And although 5 psi does not sound like much, it still easily turns a 100 horsepower engine into a 130 horsepower engine. So we're getting a 750cc to 800cc engine that packs the punch of a 1000cc 1-liter engine, but still has the emissions of a 750 to 800cc engine. So in theory, both governments and consumers should be happy. The other drawback is, of course, that a e-motor needs a upgraded electrical system in the form of a larger battery, larger alternator, and that does increase weight. As an example, a similar technology on Audi's 3-liter engines increased weight by 10 kilograms. If we scale this to a 800cc engine, then we can expect a weight increase of somewhere around 2.7 kilograms, which doesn't sound too bad. And the overall parasitic loss from a larger alternator should still be a bit smaller than from a traditional turbocharger maxed out at 5 psi of boost, which means that overall power gains should still be a bit larger with the e-compressor. Of course, the larger battery and the larger alternator do increase the emissions footprint of the vehicle in their own way, but it's realistically impossible to calculate by how much, so we're just gonna go with the trend and completely ignore this. And now, it's time to handle the engine balance of the V3 engine. Now, intuitively, a V3 engine seems like something very unbalanced. We have two cylinders on one side of the V and one cylinder on the other side of the V. And as we know, two is greater than one. So it looks like some sort of rocking vibration nightmare, yet it is not. Now, Honda is one of the very, very few manufacturers that has the experience of mass producing V3 engines, and they did it on two bikes in the past, the MVX250F and later the NSR400R. However, both of these were 90-degree V3 two-stroke engines, and Honda achieved a good, or possibly even perfect, primary balance in these engines by increasing the reciprocating mass of the rear unpaired cylinder. This was done by increasing the mass of the small end of the connecting rod, the part of the connecting rod that only reciprocates. Primary balance was then achieved just like in a conventional 90-degree V-twin or V-4 engine, where the counterweights balance out the equal reciprocating masses present in both cylinder banks. However, the new V3 engine is not 90 degrees, it is 75 degrees. But that's an important clue in itself, the 75 degrees, because back in 2001, Honda patented a odd cylinder number V-type internal combustion engine. This patent then materialized in the extremely successful RC211V, a MotoGP bike which dominated MotoGP, with its V5 engine. And that V5 had 75.5 degrees between the banks of its V. Now, I do have an old video which covers in depth and gradually how the V5 works, so here I'll just cut right to the chase. The gist of it is that the balancing methodology applied to the V5 is also largely applicable to a V3. Let's see how it works. Now, this is how the engine itself should look like. And here we have the two front pistons. As you can see, they have zero offset from each other in terms of their crank pins. And then we have the rear unpaired piston. The crank pin of this piston is offset 105 degrees from the crank pin of the two front pistons. This means that when the two front pistons are at top dead center, the rear piston is at bottom dead center. As you can see, the crankshaft counterweight of the paired front pistons does not directly oppose them when they are at top dead center. Instead, the crankshaft counterweight is pointed 75 degrees from the center line of the rear cylinder, and as such, it produces a force in that direction. Of course, the front two pistons also create an inertial force when they're at top dead center. So what we have is an inertial force 75 degrees before the rear cylinder center line, and another 75 degrees after the rear cylinder center line. These two forces may be equal in magnitude, but they are not directly opposed, so they cannot cancel each other, which means that they are instead producing a resultant force. And that resultant force will, of course, be in the direction of the rear cylinder. At the same time, the rear unpaired piston is at bottom dead center, which means that it's producing another force. And this force is, of course, directly opposed to the resultant force in the center line of the rear cylinder. All we have to do now is add enough mass to the counterweight or some other part associated with the unpaired piston, and voila, we have just restored perfect balance. Of course, all of this works equally well when the rear piston is at top dead center and the front pistons are at bottom dead center. As you can see, the forces again cancel each other out. And finally, here you can see nearly the same approach explained with this graph, which you can find in Honda's patent from 2001 that we mentioned before. As you can see, a V3 engine can have perfect primary balance without balancing shafts, which is something that an inline 3 cannot do. However, to have perfect primary balance, the V3 must have an uneven firing interval. But as we know from all sorts of V-twins and V4s and 270-degree inline twins, an uneven firing interval really isn't a drawback on motorcycles because it gives the engine this sort of unique and interesting sound character. Now, what I just told you about the crankshaft configuration is really an educated guess based on Honda's past endeavors and basic physics, because Honda really has not released official info on the crankshaft configuration. So I'm really curious to see what the actual final configuration is once they release the engine, to see whether I got it right or not, because there are other ways you can do a V3 that give you different sorts of, you know, benefits and compromises. Okay, so we have talked about the V3 anatomy, we have talked about the electrical compressor, we have talked about the engine balance, and now it's time to talk about New Year's resolutions. Let's face it, 2024 is almost over, and you're probably going to do it again, make these unrealistic New Year's resolutions that you're going to abandon by mid-January. Well, I've got one for you. I've got one for you that can do you good, and that's actually easy to stick to. Become brilliant. Become brilliant by learning stuff with brilliant. And why should you learn about stuff with brilliant? Well, it's fun, easy, intuitive, it can help you with your studies or even your career, and you won't drop it all that soon because brilliant adapts itself to your available free time and creates a learning schedule that suits you. Explanations on brilliant are visual and relatable, so you're not just memorizing, but genuinely understanding the concept, which means that it stays with you pretty much forever. And it doesn't matter what you're interested in, be it computer science, programming, data science, technology, it's all in there. If you go over to bruant.org/d4a, you can try every feature Bruant has to offer for free for a full 30 days. And if you decide that you like it, accessing it through the same link will also give you 20% off an annual premium subscription.